I'm Teresa Buckle, and my husband and I have been together for 58 years, and we got married in 1955, and I don't know what else to say.
I'm Darryl Buckle. Was Brittany, believe it or not, Darryl Cletus Morton, but that was during the first 4 years of my life. Then I was adopted, and I became Darryl Buckle, which everybody knows now, including thousands of local school kids, because I used to go visit them in the various schools while I was a policeman. But I, as my wife has said, we got married in 55, and we live here in Hamilton now, and I've always been living here in Hamilton, although not in this apartment. One of the things that I should mention is this is our 14th place that we have lived in since we've been married. But that's another story for another time. If you have a couple more hours of tape, we might be able to get by and explain that to you. But I doubt it.
Him through a girlfriend of mine. We were both, my girlfriend and I were waiting. She lived in Waterdown, I lived in Aldershot, and we were both waiting for our respective buses. And he came trotting through, and he worked just around the corner from my girlfriend. And so they had met previously, and so my girlfriend introduced me to Darryl, and I thought, boy, is he ever tall.
So I don't know exactly what the connection was, but I thought she was pretty nice anyhow. But she was very quiet, very dignified, very refined. She always had a chaperone, one of her cousins with her. And I thought, she was a little on the mousy side a couple of times, but I persevered, and we got four boys to prove it. She wasn't as pristine as I thought she would be.
my grandmother was really upset and because I didn't follow what she had thought I would be doing, you know. And
her grandmother had thought that her sister would be a nurse, which she was, and that Teresa would be a piano teacher and take care of the grandmother.
I took piano lessons and I went up as high as grade 10 and in piano and theory and that. So she wanted me to be a piano teacher, and she and I would live together, and I would, you know, sort of support her, and she would look after wherever we lived, sort of thing. So of course when Darryl came along, why, he threw those plans all into a
a cocked hat, shall we
say. she did eventually come to accept them. One of her remarks was, well, I guess you could go a lot further and get a lot worse.
And of course her sister was a little bit hanky about it, because I was taking her best friend away from her when we got married. But sister was really a lovely, lovely lady.
We were quite close and did a lot of devilish things together, and
they were known in the area as the Bratty Brunners, by the way, because Brunner was her name, was a grandmother's name. But all this I found out after I'd married her. I found out that much after I married her about it. As a matter of fact, my wife mentioned that she had a friend that introduced us. Well, I was very seriously thinking about putting the hustle on her friend, and so she introduced me to Teresa. We got married in Burlington, which was her church in Burlington and so on.
St. John's on Bryant Street.
our first born came 3 days after our first anniversary, so everything was on legit and up and up. The only thing was that I had to become Catholic if I wanted to marry her. That was the one position. Well, by that time I wanted she so badly that I said, hey, if you'd been a Mohammedan or Swahili, I'd have joined the tribe in order to get into her pants. But I'm sorry.
It's been an exciting 58 years.
It's been a joy. We've had a few rough spots and a few thin spots, but it has been a real joy. And
it hasn't been dull.
Pardon?
It hasn't been dull.
No, it hasn't. She has never once mentioned divorce or separation.
Okay. That would be too easy. I'm sticking around so that you really suffer.
I think possibly she may have thought of murder a couple of times, but thank goodness I'm sorted way up there so she can't get at it too easily. As she was a lot of policemen friend of mine used to bug around a lot. Hey, that was their business. A couple of them made pass at Teresa. I knew that. But Teresa turned them down. Didn't you?
Of course.
I got four boys and they threatened, I'm sure, that they'd run the family jewels up to see the old flagpole. They ever thought out of their old man buggering around. So, like I say, it's as much fear of what my poor boy to do to me. But it's been enjoyable, really. It's impossible to say what was the best or what was the worst. The worst, of course, was last March, I suppose. The most recent when we lost our second-born son. That was bad for it.
He was a diabetic, and he was in and out of the general. Because his blood sugars would be too high or too low. But they usually got him into the hospital, before anything more serious happened. But this time they couldn't bring him back, and he passed away in the hospital. We got a call early in the morning, and I got off and answered it, and there was a couple of policemen at the door, and they told us that Stephen had passed away. So we immediately called our youngest son David, because he just lived over here on Wood Street. He came over and took over, and like he arranged everything, and he arranged the viewing and the funeral and the burial and that, which was good for us, because we weren't in any great shape to go through it ourselves, but David took over, and family, I think, is the thing. That was family, you can pretty well survive a lot of things.
I thank the good Lord for this young lady's influence a lot on helping the boys become the fine men that they all four of them were. But I say that's the way things have been.
I think we've survived because of the boys and their spouses and that, like, and friends that have sort of gathered around us and sort of supported us and saw us through and as much as Darryl says, I allow him to do a lot of his things that he likes to do, but he also allows me to do what I want to do too, you know. So I think it's a lot of give and take. I think each of us, to a certain extent, gives in to the other. Not that we're taking over, but we just seem to mesh very well, and I keep saying to him, as long as he does as he's told, he's okay.
Yes, ma'am.
I don't know whether I would call it the golden years, because of all the aches and pains that you have, you know. But it's you know, I don't think growing old is that bad, and it's part of life, you know. And if the time comes, I certainly won't fight against going into a nursing home, and I don't think you would either, would you?
No, not at all. Again, I realize that I have certain have dementia. I have to use a wheelchair, okay? This is part of going old. But rather than inflict myself upon my children, I'd rather do the same thing as Rita. I certainly don't want to live as a vegetable for another 20 years. I've had a good time. This is still working. That's all that matters to me, because I've got a few inconveniences, shall we say, as far as having a stroke and having survived cancer some 10 or 12 years ago. Hey, I'm still here, and she's still here beside me. That's all that matters. No, I don't have any advice, because I am so different from everybody else. She is so different from everybody else. And either you mesh or you don't mesh. Well, fortunately, for some reason, we mesh. That may or may not ever happen to you or anybody else. It's been luck, a great deal. It has been luck in the fact that we tolerate each other. We both have a good sense of humor. And I think that helps a great deal, because if you don't laugh about something, you surely will cry about them, and we have done. Both laughed and both cried together and at each other. We understood each other, we tolerated each other, we loved each other, and we're friends. It's not going to happen to everybody, we know that. But fortunately, Therese and I have managed to tolerate, put up with, love each other. So, therefore, that's it. All you can do is hope.
Show the world, world's gotta see all the love.